could have broken down in lots of different ways, right? She could have failed to understand what he was trying to say. She could have feared him despite all that. And lots of things could have gone wrong. In this particular case, they didn't. And the reason why we start the book actually with this anecdote is because these kind of uncertainties, which we call shadows of doubt, they hang over all manner of interactions. Actually, they hang over interactions that we engage in multiple times every day, whenever we interact with strangers. But in the criminal justice system, they take on a huge amount of importance because the ways in which these interactions play out can mean, you know, either good things or bad things for people to an extreme degree. So these shadows of doubt, they hang all over all manner of interactions, including, for instance, those involving personal crimes. Personal crimes, and I'll talk especially about robbery and murder. So robbery often involves interactions between strangers. They don't know much about each other. Victim and offender, in that case, they cannot get letters of recommendation from the previous person with whom the other party interacted with. They have to make judgments and guesses, you know, should I comply with this or not? Is this person going to be violent if I don't? But more important than that, even prior to this interaction taking place, there's a victim selection process. So, you know, and this is, you know, if you look at ethnographies of active offenders, they're actually going through this, you know, and they will try to pick people whom they stereotype as being compliant. They don't want to get into trouble. They don't want to get into a fight. And so these kind of beliefs about beliefs start to play a role. Same thing with murder. With murder, you'll be surprised, but a lot of homicides take place between strangers because there's an escalating dispute and you don't know where it's going to end. And you make judgments about whether or not you're in danger from this other person. And if you're in danger, even if they have nothing to gain by killing them, you may be better off doing it preemptively than being killed by them. And this happens repeatedly. In stops and searches, so when you know police conduct stops and searches of vehicles or pedestrians, they have to do so by law under a standard called reasonable articulable suspicion. Well, how do they form these beliefs about reasonable suspicion? Are they dependent on the appearance of the other person? Or are they just simply dependent on what they're doing, the exact articulable characteristics of the interaction? They could be conditioned also by stereotypes, beliefs about people's likelihood of being up to no good. Police homicides, in fact, legally, again, the only justification for these is if, at least in the federal, under the federal statutes, only justification for a police taking the life of a civilian if they fear that the civilian is going to take their life or somebody else's life or cause great harm. But how do you form these beliefs? Again, it's quite possible that stereotypes may condition the formation of these beliefs. Witness cooperation. A lot of witness cooperation takes place, uncompensated. Actually, people cooperating at witnesses are doing a public good, but they're not really getting anything for it other than the sense that they're contributing to the pursuit of justice. But it really matters a lot whether or not your witness testimony is corroborated. So your beliefs about whether other witnesses are going to come forward are going to affect the way in which you behave. And this can give rise, I'll talk a little bit about, to collective silence, or you know, where silence begets silence. If you don't expect other people to testify, you're not going to have an incentive to testify. You may face extreme retaliation, and that's going to make you silent. And you know, we saw this actually with the Harvey Weinstein verdict very recently, and I'll show you exactly how these sort of cultures of silence can emerge in lots of different contexts. Bail decisions. In many jurisdictions, the judge is required to release somebody or to withhold, you know, prevent release of somebody if they believe that they're not going to show up at trial or if they're going to be arrested for another crime while they're out. And again, how do they form these judgments? Based on the information that they have, do they take into account visual characteristics that are contaminated by stereotypes? Jury deliberations. You have to decide whether beyond a reasonable doubt somebody is guilty or innocent. Again, how are those perceptions then formed? What's the basis for those things? So that's really what the book is about. If I don't get through all of my slides, that's the sort of scope of the argument. And I'll try to get through. So since we're talking about stereotypes, let's define them. And stereotypes often used in a have very negative connotations, and we think of them as having emotional valence and being associated with antipathy or contempt. But they don't have to be. You know, what we mean by stereotypes is simply belief about an individual based on characteristics of a group to which they're perceived to belong. They may or may not belong, but we think, we classify them, we categorize them, and we form beliefs about them, about things that we don't actually know, but we care about and want to know. That's all we mean by stereotypes when I use the word. Now, words like stigma can be used for the more sort of contemptible view of other people, but this is what we mean by stereotypes. So let's think a bit about this. So this could be based on ethnicity, gender, on religion, perceived religion, accents, tattoos, piercings. All of these things can affect the way in which we classify, categorize, and form expectations about people. You know, a taxi driver, for example, can you know can look at somebody and make a judgment about, in the old days, pre-Uber days at least, there's a different kind of stereotyping that goes on with Uber and Lyft, but in the old days, you know, may pass somebody whom they believe is going to go to a, you know, a neighborhood they don't want to go to, or give them a small tip, or may try to rob them, and so on. A waiter can give good or bad service to a diner on expectations of whether they're going to reward that behavior generously or not. Doctor, when a patient is saying, look, I'm at a 6 on a scale of 1 to 10 with regard to pain, how do you interpret that? You might interpret it one way with one patient as opposed to another. You might believe that one person is exaggerating, whereas the other person is understating their level of pain. Teacher and a student, you get a fantastic piece of work. You know, what's your belief about whether it's plagiarized or not? Is this a phenomenal piece of work by an incredibly hardworking, talented person, or did they just copy it off the internet? Those beliefs can be affected by your stereotypes. So it happens a lot. My focus, of course, will be on the kinds of interactions I just discussed in the previous slide. Now, stereotypes affect behavior directly as well as indirectly. Now, Chris talked about in his introduction, very kind introduction, thank you, Chris, if you're out there. He talked about rationality, about economics making assumptions about rationality, and that's what we had to depart from. So we had to start with the psychology literature, because we can't really assume that these beliefs are formed in any sort of rational way. But once you take account of the fact that these beliefs exist, you can start looking at the incentives that they create. Once people have, no matter how incorrect the beliefs may be, they're going to start acting in ways that those beliefs then guide. And that's where the economics comes in. So because economics, the bread and butter of economics is incentive. So once those beliefs are out there and beliefs about beliefs are out there, you can start thinking about, well, how does this affect behavior? And that's what we're trying to do. And if there's one sort of summary view of what this book tries to do, is it tries to demystify the data. It tries to show you that what we can see around the world, around us in the world, especially about different behaviors and different outcomes and attributes of different groups, can be understood by understanding, looking at beliefs and looking at behavior. You don't have to resort to essentialist views about certain groups being prone to behave in particular ways. You know, if you look at the opportunities, you look at the beliefs, you look at the incentives, you look at beliefs about them, you can pretty much explain what's going on with regard to the data that we see. That's really, in a nutshell, what we're trying to say in this book. But once you stereotype, once you believe you are stereotyped by others, that's going to affect your behavior. And in some cases, it'll cause you to avoid interactions. You don't want to be negatively stereotyped. And there'll be some cases, and I'll give you examples, where you actually want to seek out interactions, where you'll be stereotyped in ways that are favorable to you. Okay, let me just very quickly tell you about a riddle that's very famous, and you know many of you will have heard already. It was in a 1990s movie, and this particular extract is taken from a book that was, you know, a very good book that I'll tell you about in just a second. But just take a look at this, and if you've seen it before, just think about the first time that you saw it, right? Your reaction to this the first time that you saw it. So here it is. Father and his son are in a car accident. The father dies at the scene, and the son, badly injured, is rushed to the hospital. In the operating room, the surgeon looks at the boy and says, I can't operate on this boy. He's my son. How can this be? So think back. You know, I mean, some of you have heard this many times probably, but think back to the first time you heard it. And I've tried this a few times with students and other audience members. Some people are puzzled. Oh, you know, I don't know. I don't see how this could be. Some people think, it's quite a common answer to this puzzle, is to think about, nowadays at least, to think about same-sex couples, that the fact that, oh, maybe this kid has got two dads. Some other people think, oh, maybe it's adopted. You know, maybe there's a biological father, there's an adopted father, and, you know, there's got two dads. You know. But basically, the thinking quite often directs people to think about how could this child have two fathers? But statistically, just based on data, if you were just statistically accurate, if you were rational in the sense that Chris was talking about earlier, what would be the answer to the riddle? It's the boy's mom, right? The surgeon is the boy's mom. But it doesn't come to mind, and it doesn't come to mind even for, you know, young women who are taking pre-med classes and preparing to enter the medical profession. I've seen it, and they're quite distressed at the fact that it doesn't come to mind. But you know, this is what it's supposed to illustrate. And you've seen, actually, this is from a book, Blind Spot, by Mazin Banerjee, who was also, or maybe still, affiliated with SFI, and her co-author, Anthony Greenwald. Now, this kind of thing crops up more, you know, a lot of times in the media. This is one that you may have seen a couple of years ago about, you know, a passenger on a flight who tried to help an unresponsive patient because she's a doctor, and was told, you know, oh no, sweetie, put your hand down. We're looking for actual physicians or nurses or some type of medical personnel. We don't have time to talk to you now. Now, Tamika Cross, who was a physician, I think Houston-based, was a black woman. But once this was published, a whole bunch of accounts, similar accounts, came from white women, from Asian women. And it was published in the Washington Post, you know, a whole series of responses where people was, you know, judged not to be what they were, what they actually were. Now, why do we stereotype? So bear in mind that I'm thinking about stereotypes not as something that is laden with emotional content or contempt necessarily, right? So why do we just form these beliefs about people, about things that, you know, we don't have direct information? So psychologists have looked at this for 100 years or more. And there's a beautiful article by Jerome Bruner in 1957 called Going Beyond the Information Given. So when we stereotype, we are going beyond the information given. We're given some information and we try to put in place, you know, stuff that we are not told about, because we need to know that stuff, because our behavior is going to be informed by it. And Bruner's argument is that, you know, it's part of the cognitive machinery that allows us to deal with novelty in daily life. Now, you all walked in here and you sat down in these chairs, I suspect, without testing to see if the chair is going to take your weight. Now, it's quite possible that the chair that you chose could have fallen, maybe it could have been broken. But, you know, you've sat on lots of chairs before, and, you know, you just don't feel the need to do that. And you basically just stereotype that chair. You know, it's not that chair. You never sat on that particular chair before. And you basically assume that it's going to just fit in with, you know, that sort of concept of chair that you have in your mind. This is the kind of process that is being described over here. So we'd be too swamped by the complexity of our environment. We'd be unable to take actions if we just tried to treat every single situation as unique. The word stereotype comes from a book by Walter Lippmann in 1922 called Public Opinion, which I highly recommend that you read, not only because of the insights in the book, but also because it's so beautifully written. I'll give you a couple of examples, and I'll end with one actually in the talk. So Walter Lippmann says, were there no practical uniformities in the environment, there would be no economy and only error in the human habit of accepting foresight for sight. So that's, you know, just one of very nice way to say what we do when we stereotype. We accept foresight for sight. But he goes on, there are uniformities sufficiently accurate and the need for economizing attention so inevitable that the abandonment of all stereotypes for a wholly innocent approach to experience would impoverish human life. So this is the psychologist sort of thinking about, you know, at least the way in which I have defined stereotypes for the purposes of this talk. But there's a problem with this. And the problem is that once the stereotype is in place, it affects how we process evidence. So this is from Gordon Allport's book, The Nature of Prejudice, 1954. Where he says, look, we selectively admit new evidence to a category if it confirms us in our previous belief, but we find evidence that is contrary. If we find evidence that is contrary to our preconception, we're likely to grow resistant. So basically, it affects the way in which you process evidence, so the stereotype gets entrenched. You just ignore the evidence that contradicts it and keep being highly receptive to evidence that confirms it. It's what psychologists call confirmatory bias, and you end up then not necessarily moving towards the reality of the situation. Go back to Lippmann again, and again, he'll say the same thing, but much more beautifully expressed. He says, you know, for the most part, we do not first see and then define. We define first and then see. What is alien will be rejected. What is different will fall upon unseeing eyes. So this is the problem. We can't assume that stereotypes are rational, that they fit statistical reality. Different people will end up with different beliefs, and then once they're there, they're going to be stuck there to some degree. Although, you know, there are things one can do to change that, which I'll get back to. Stereotypes of criminality, so that's the topic of discussion today, have associated for over 100 years, especially since the 1890 census, with African Americans in the United States. They were, and this is from a book by Khalil Muhammad called The Condemnation of Blackness, another excellent book, but he talks about how stereotypes of criminality were associated actually quite extensively with Italian Americans and Irish Americans also at one time. But those faded, whereas the association of criminality with African Americans did not fade. It has deepened, it has become entrenched. And this is part of the, you know, what we need to take into account of if we want to look at criminal justice issues today. But I'm going to give you an example that blew my mind when I first saw it. And that tells us how stereotypes have changed. And this is an example that goes back to Mississippi in the 1890s. And Mississippi in the 1890s was facing the fact that, you know, the constitutional amendments had given the right to vote to black men. Women would not get the right to vote for another generation, but black men had gotten the right to vote. And they wanted to take away that right to vote, you know, without violating the federal constitution. This is what the Mississippi Constitutional Convention and the Supreme Court wanted to do quite deliberately, and they thought they could do it. And they thought they could do it by engaging in felony disenfranchisement, by being very selective about the crimes that would disqualify you from the vote. And so this is what they did. It's quite fascinating if you think about it from today's perspective. So what they did is burglary, theft, arson, and obtaining money under false pretenses were declared to be disqualifications from voting. You could not vote if you were convicted of these crimes. Whereas robbery and murder and other crimes in which violence was the principal ingredient was not. So Mississippi decided, and this stuck around for decades, that if you kill somebody, you can vote, but if you committed fraud, you couldn't. Right? Why did they do that? Here's why, very explicitly. Because they held the stereotype of African Americans as a patient, docile people, but careless, landless, and migratory within narrow limits, without forethought, its criminal members given rather to furtive offenses than to the robust crimes of the whites. And they did not want to deny the vote to the whites. And so therefore, they allowed the murderers to vote. They did not see, you know, black Americans, or men in particular, as being capable of murder to the degree that they saw black men to be capable of fraud. And so they, you know, and they felt that this was constitutionally permissible, and the Supreme Court allowed it for a generation after this. That just sort of shows you how, so this kind of tailoring would now be impermissible under the Constitution, but at that time was viewed as permissible. But it just shows you also how stereotypes have changed over the 100 years or so since that time. Nowadays, the stereotype with regard to violence, especially with regard to violent crimes, is associated with African Americans, unlike the case that I just quoted you from the 1890s in Mississippi, where it was more likely to be associated with whites. So here's something that's taken from the memoir of Brent Staples. Brent Staples is a writer, you may know, for the New York Times, but he also has a PhD in psychology from the University of Chicago. And when he was a graduate student, he was a tall, well-built young man, and he would like to take walks by the lake in Chicago. And what he found was that people were, afraid of him. They would shrink from him. You know, they were worried about being robbed by him or being attacked by him. And so he says he became an expert in the language of fear. Couples locked arms and reached for each other's hand when they saw me. Some crossed to the other side of the street. People who were carrying on conversations went mute and stared straight ahead as though avoiding my eyes would save them. I tried to be innocuous, but I didn't know how. I began to avoid people. I turned out of my way to side streets to spare them the sense that they were being stalked. It made him deeply uncomfortable that people were afraid of him and they had no reason to be. And he wanted to avoid this feeling. But then he came up with a solution that has become very famous, actually, and adopted by in another very nice book by Claude Steele. But I'll tell you what his solution was. So he says, out of nervousness, I began to whistle and discovered I was good at it. My whistle was pure and sweet and also in tune. On the street at night, I whistled popular tunes from the Beatles and Vivaldi's Four Seasons. The tension drained from people's bodies when they heard me. A few even smiled as they passed me in the dark. So he was able to shift these stereotypes through whistling Vivaldi. Whistling Vivaldi is the title of a book by Claude Steele that tries to look at these issues, the famous Stanford psychologist. And this is a very famous passage in this book. You may be quite familiar with it. But what is much less famous, and that's actually more relevant to what I'm going to say, is what happened next, because he got sick of this. And you can imagine the sort of toll it takes. He got tired of this, and he started actually to act in stereotype-confirming ways. So here's what happened. This is in the memoir, too, but it's much less well-known. So he says, one night I stooped beneath the branches and came up on the other side, just as a couple was stepping from their car to their townhouse. The woman pulled her purse close with one hand and reached for her husband with the other. The two of them stood frozen as I bore down on them. I felt a surge of power. These people were mine. I could do with them as I wished. If I'd been younger with less to lose, I'd have robbed them and it would have been easy. All I'd have to do was stand silently before them until they surrendered their money. Now, Brent Staples was not interested in robbing anybody or getting their money. Right? He's interested in finishing up his psychology degree. But he realized that were he to do that, it would be easy. Were he to want to take somebody else's property, he faces the choice, right? He faces the choice among a whole bunch of what we in the book call crimes of appropriation. Here they are: robbery, burglary, larceny, motor vehicle theft. These are the four major crimes of appropriation that the FBI tracks in its index of crime. And robbery, by definition over here, as you can see, is the taking or attempting to take anything of value from the care, custody, or control of a person or persons by force, or threat of force, or violence, and or by putting the victim in fear. If you're going to take somebody else's property, and people are just not afraid of you, if they tell you to get lost, if they just sort of, walk away, you're going to try to pick burglary, larceny, motor vehicle theft. That's going to be, a more appealing, more attractive choice. If people are terrified of you, and they're going to give you your money just if you stand in front of them, you're going to pick robbery. The selection among crimes, if you're going to commit a crime like this, you're going to get people who are not feared pick the crimes of appropriation which do not require interpersonal contact, And where stereotypes don't come into play. You could be burgled, your house could be burgled while you're on vacation, you don't find out for a week later, you have no contact with the person who did it. So there's no role for stereotypes over there. And so therefore the patterns that we see in the data on burglary should differ, we would expect, from those that we see with regard to robbery. It'll differ for a number of reasons. Firstly, with regard to victim compliance, you know, victim compliance will be based on the fear. This is what Brent Staples is talking about. But then so will victim selection. Because again, if you go back to Elizabeth Anderson's quote, there's beliefs about beliefs and beliefs about beliefs about beliefs. And so basically, people who are engaged in robbery will select victims whom they will stereotype as having particularly negative stereotypes about them. Right? And let me show you what the data looks like with regard to robbery. So this is from the National Crime Victimization Survey. And you see the largest category of robberies right here is white on white, about 39% over this period. And you see that white offenders, so here's the offender race or ethnicity as perceived by the victim. So, you know, this is a victim survey. It may not be reported to the police, but it's reported to the surveyor. You'll find that white offenders will almost always just exclusively target white victims. They just do not target black victims. Black offenders are completely equal opportunity. They will target, you know, white victims and black victims. And you get, actually, it says 14 to 1 over here, but actually it's about 17 to 1 in this data. This is because of rounding. 17 to 1 difference between black on white robbery as opposed to white on robbery. And robbery is very unusual. It's one of the only crimes which is not within group. Most of the serious crimes like rape and murder, aggravated assault, takes place really within group. Robbery is one that crosses lines in a very particular way. And one way to understand this is basically that the incentives that are created by these stereotypes are driving people one way versus another, driving white offenders to select white victims or to select burglary, motor vehicle theft, larceny, and black victims to select robbery, and in particular, to select white victims. And you see this actually in the arrest data. Now, arrest data is not the same as offending data, but it's not a bad proxy either, at least with regard to these crimes. And you see that, you know, if you look at the African-American share of total arrests, it's much, much smaller for these other crimes of appropriation than with regard to robbery. White offenders, you know, are disproportionately choosing these other crimes, and black offenders are disproportionately choosing robbery. Why does this matter? It matters because robbery is going to get you in jail. Robbery is going to get you arrested, and robbery is going to end up with a heavier sentence. And so the population of offenders that we see, the people that we see who are arrested, the people who we see who are incarcerated, are disproportionately the ones who are choosing robbery. And you can see that here. This is work by Stephen Raphael and Michael Stoll. And if you just look at 2009, for example, robbery is actually not as common as burglary. This is crimes per 100,000 residents. It's less common than burglary and motor vehicle theft, right? Burglary is, you know, even more common than motor vehicle theft. So this is just the commission of these crimes. But it is much more likely, again, if you look here, 31% will end up in arrested. Of those, of the crimes, 31% lead to an arrest for robbery, only 14% for burglary, 10% for motor vehicle theft. And then if you look here, prison admission per arrest, 28% for robbery, 19 and 11. So you're more likely to be arrested, and conditional arrest, you're more likely to end up in prison. So there's a mismatch which we don't see, it's hidden from us. There's a mismatch between the population of people that we see arrested and incarcerated and the racial composition of the population that we see in our jails, in our prisons, and in our dockets, compared to the population of people who are actually committing crimes of appropriation. There's a mismatch between these two. But we don't see this mismatch. And so what happens is that the very stereotypes that are driving these kind of incentives get entrenched by what we see with regard to incarceration and with regard to arrest. And it's what my former colleague and friend Marcellus Andrews calls the stereotype trap. The stereotypes exist, they lead to certain types of behavior. Certain things get, and for reasons that may have nothing to do with bias, certain types of crimes like robbery are more quickly reported, there's a victim description. You know, it's quite understandable why they would more likely lead to an arrest. But they then come back, feedback, and just entrench this very same stereotype that gives rise to these patterns of behavior. Homicide. It's the only serious crime that potentially involves preemption. No serious crime is something that you would do to somebody else just because you're afraid that they would do to you. But in many escalating disputes, this is exactly the incentive structure that arises with homicide. So here's the logic, and this is from a 1960 book by Thomas Schelling. I should keep an eye on the time, actually. You will, yeah? Jessica, you'll give me some warning? Yeah. Okay. Because I could just go on endlessly. This is from Schelling. So he describes, this is something called the burglar paradox. So he describes a situation where, you know, if I go downstairs to investigate a noise at night with a gun in my hand, find myself face to face with a burglar who has a gun in his hand, there's a danger of an outcome that neither of us desires. Even if he prefers just to leave quietly and I wish him to, there's a danger that he may think I want to shoot and shoot first. Worse, there's a danger that he may think that I think he wants to shoot, or he may think that I think he thinks I want to shoot, and so on. And basically, the preemptive motive, and not just the preemptive motive, but the, you know, but the fear of preemption on the part of the other, or the fear that they may think that you're going to preempt, and so on and so forth, up the hierarchy of beliefs, can lead to an outcome, and, you know, we both would rather just completely avoid. And this is how he summarized it, and I think there's a lot of deep insight in this one sentence. He says, self-defense is ambiguous when one is only trying to preclude being shot in self-defense. You know, how do you actually define self-defense? You know, you can say that, oh, I thought that he was going to, you know, shoot me, so I shot him, or I thought that he would think that I was going to shoot him, so he shot me. So this whole, you know, the whole definition sort of collapses under its own weight, in a sense. Now, this is actually very common. So Dan and I, a long time ago, you know, we were studying homicide in Newark, and a large number of killings were actually based on relatively trivial escalating disputes about a debt, about infidelity, that just spiraled out of control, and the preemptive motive, and also later the retaliatory motive, can come into play. And these people are people who don't necessarily know each other very well. Although we think of, you know, the popular homicides in movies and in the press are ones where, you know, that don't fit that pattern. But it's not uncommon. But what it does, what this kind of reasoning does, is tells you that there's a connection between fearsomeness and fearfulness. Basically, these go hand in hand. They're two sides of the same coin. If somebody is fearsome, if people are afraid of them, then that person ought to be afraid. Why? Because they are more likely to be killed preemptively. If somebody is afraid, then they're also dangerous, because that fear can drive them to behave preemptively. It doesn't happen a lot. It doesn't happen often, but it happens often enough to affect the incidence of homicide. Now, why would you be especially afraid? If you're in an escalating dispute, weapons are involved, or potentially involved, you fear that they may be involved, why would you be afraid? One of the reasons you may be afraid is if you think that your life can be taken with impunity. If you believe that if you were killed, the person who killed you will not be brought to justice. If you believe that you can be killed with impunity, then you know that the constraints that are holding back the other person are limited, and that gives you the stronger motive to act preemptively. And if both parties to the dispute can be killed with impunity, then this cascading set of beliefs actually can lead to very high rates of homicide. Okay? Now, who is killed with impunity? So the Washington Post has done an incredible collection of data, actually a lot of data around these issues that I'm talking about. We don't have official data on, and media sources like The Guardian and The Washington Post have done an amazing job, actually, of putting this together. Who can be killed with impunity in America? Not just today, but going back a century or more. So the Washington Post study, which looked at about 55,000 homicides, found that black victims who accounted for the majority of homicides were the least likely of any racial group to have their killings result in an arrest. Now think about the implications of this, right? If you can be killed with impunity, whether or not you are killed with somebody who's black or white, that's not the key issue here. The issue is, if you can be killed with impunity with whoever it is that you're tangling with, that gives you incentives to take preemptive action, and that can actually feed higher rates of homicides. There's a link between the homicide clearance rate, the rate at which homicides are solved, leading to an arrest or leading to a special clearance where, you know, you can't arrest because the person has absconded, or because, you know, if you identify the offender but you can't arrest, that is also a homicide clearance. If the clearance rate is low, then you can be killed with impunity. Now, why is it low? So if you ask law enforcement officers why is it low, they argue that it is not because they don't care. At least homicide detectives, to a person, insist that they have very strong incentives to clear every single homicide. The reason that they say that they can't do it is because they don't get witness cooperation. So they basically, you know, they say in many cases they may even know a killer's identity but cannot get witnesses to cooperate out of fear of retaliation and mistrust of law enforcement. So let's look at these two things: fear of retaliation and mistrust of law enforcement, because both those things matter, and, you know, both those things are linked to stereotypes and stops and searches and so on that I'll talk about here. Okay, So here's one from 2007. This is a very dramatic case, but you can find other cases like this. This is a seven-year-old girl who was on a bicycle, got shot by a stray bullet. There were 20 witnesses. One of them included the little girl's grandmother, but none of them were willing to come forward. And at the bottom, the grandma says, I'm not going to talk to the police for fear that she'd have to move out of the country. So the fear of retaliation can prevent witness cooperation. Now, why is there more fear of retaliation sometimes relative to other times? Why do witnesses sometimes come forward and other times don't? Witness cooperation carries many risks, very few private benefits other than the satisfaction of seeing justice done. Testimony is most effective when it's corroborated. So, if somebody else is going to come forward, there's a certain collective action problem here. If lots of people are willing to come forward as witnesses, it's fine for you to come forward. You'd carry much less risk, right? And it's more likely that that witness testimony, because it's corroborated, will be effective in court. Retaliation is also less likely if many testify. If many people testify, then it's less likely that the individual against whom they're testifying can retaliate against them. And also there's a diffusion of responsibility, right? They're not, there's not one person for them to target. And this is what economists refer to as strategic complementarity. If a lot of people do it, then there's incentives for even more to join in. If nobody does it, then nobody wants to start. There's what economists call a first mover disadvantage, right? You don't want to be the first to do this. And this can cause silence to beget silence, and it can cause entrenched reticence in some communities. Now, I'll give you two examples. But once a witness comes forward, you can get the floodgates opening. And I want to give you two examples of this that are not really widely connected with each other. One is the example that I gave you already with regard to the stray bullet that's killing. And it's a gang-related killing. Nobody wants to come forward. They're afraid, and because they're pretty sure that nobody else is going to come forward either. Now think about this other example, which is very topical actually, but in our minds is often treated very differently. But the logic is very, very similar. So there are certain crimes in which the only witness is the victim. And these are typically in cases of sexual assault, sexual harassment, and rape. Here, there's a huge first mover disadvantage because you don't even know about the existence necessarily of other victims. So, it's not just a question of are other witnesses going to testify. You're also not quite certain in many cases whether other witnesses do exist, right? And so there's this shadow of doubt hanging over these potential witnesses. So take the case of Larry Nassar. So Larry Nassar was described by prosecutors as possibly the most prolific serial child sex abuser in history. Had 156 victims, the youngest was age 6, earliest I think was age 10, 4 Olympic gold medalists. And it took 20 years of this activity before it came to light in a way that could result in a prosecution. The first witness to come forward was Rachel Denhollander, and she was described by the judge at the sentencing, she was described as the bravest person I've ever had in my courtroom. Why? Because it was that hard without knowing that anybody else would come and corroborate what you were saying to take the first step. And she did it. But as soon as she did it, floodgates opened. You had tons and tons of witnesses come forward in this case. Very similar to the case of Harvey Weinstein. You have a pattern of abuse going on for a long period of time. There's one precipitating event, and then suddenly a whole bunch of people come forward. Bill Cosby again. Roger Ailes again. That was Gretchen Carlson was the first witness to come forward. Bill O'Reilly again. And Lupita Nyong'o in an op-ed in the New York Times, said that she was sorry that she had not spoken up earlier, but was speaking up now to contribute to the end of this conspiracy of silence. The first to come forward will face intense retaliation or secret settlements. So that's why you often have, non-disclosure agreements. That's why you have large payments because to try to prevent the testimony from becoming public so that other people would then, come to light, other incidents would come to light. Or if it's already come to light, if the first witness experiences extreme retaliation, that can deter subsequent witnesses from coming forward. Here's probably the most famous example. So this is Anita Hill's case, where she did come forward reluctantly, right? And often in these cases, the first witness does come forward reluctantly. This is a Jane Mayer in a recent interview with NPR, said she was dragged through the dirt. The accused questioned her motives, called her an erotomaniac, a woman scorned, questioned her sanity, called her a liar, called her potentially a lunatic. And basically, the way Jane Mayer puts it, she served as a kind of canary in a coal mine for women about what happens when you do speak up against a powerful man, even though she hadn't asked to speak up. And the message here is basically, if you do this, this is going to happen to you. And so this can cause things to remain, suppressed for decades, as was the case with some of these offenders. Now, this is not usually linked to the gang-related homicides, the lack of witness cooperation in communities, but the logic is not that different. It's really something very similar that's going on. Now, let's go to the other reason why they're not why you have killing with impunity. Jessica, will you tell me roughly how much time?
You've got like 20 minutes.
Okay, good, good. I won't even need that whole time. Okay, I always get nervous about this, and I start speaking fast, and then, you know, so you can shout out for me to slow down if you want. That's my perennial problem, you know. That's okay, so let's think now back to the other reason why police say they can't solve homicides when the victim is black. And the other reason was mistrust of law enforcement. So this has to do then with the way in which people's routine interactions with law enforcement play out. And this is how stereotypes then affect police stops. So you have about 25 million, that's a large number of traffic stops annually in the United States, approximately every year, about 1.5 million pedestrian stops. About 2% of white drivers had their vehicle searched, and about 6% for black and Latino drivers. So conditional on being stopped, you know, once you're stopped, the chances of having your vehicle searched is about 3 times as high if you're black or Latino than if you're white. Does this mean that there's disparate treatment, that there's some bias on the part of the officer? Not necessarily, and it's very important to understand this point. This looking at this data does not, in and of itself, I'm not saying it does or it doesn't, but just this data alone cannot tell you whether there's discrimination in the sense of disparate treatment involved. Why? Because the justification for a search is what's called reasonable articulable suspicion. Maybe you saw something in the vehicle that aroused your suspicion, and you conducted a search for entirely legitimate reasons, but that these suspicions are aroused with greater frequency when you happen to stop black and Latino drivers, not because you're biased, but just because the evidence of possible wrongdoing is more frequent. This is a possibility which we can't rule out just by looking at this data. That's the point I want to make. There is work that shows that there is bias involved, but my point is you can't deduce it just from this. Right? You have to dig deeper to see whether or not there is bias involved or there isn't. And the way that Randall Kennedy, whom I quoted earlier on that Mississippi case, puts it, there's two ways in which you can have discrimination. It can be strategic or prejudiced. Strategic discrimination is if you engage in profiling, racial profiling, for instance, not out of antipathy or hatred towards a person or the desire to cause them harm, but because you believe that you have a signal that you're more likely to recover contraband. You believe that, you know, that individual strategically, just for the purposes of recovering the maximum amount of contraband, is more likely to search than somebody else, right? So this is what he calls strategic. And prejudiced is where you just, you know, do it because you get some pleasure, let's say, out of causing them pain, or because you just, you know, you have incorrect beliefs about how likely they are to be carrying something illegal. Now, how do we detect what's going on? How do we detect whether people are stopping people because they just legitimately believe that they're more likely to be carrying contraband, drugs, or weapons, or whether or not there's something off with regard to their behavior, either they are prejudiced or they have incorrect beliefs? Well, there's a test that was proposed actually by the economist Gary Becker called the hit rate test. It's part of a class of tests called outcome-based tests. And basically his point was, look, if you observe that you're recovering contraband with higher frequency when you stop one group of people compared to another group, that's evidence of bias. And the basic idea is this: if you're stopping a whole bunch of people, suppose that you're stopping black and Latino motorists or pedestrians, and the rate at which you're recovering contraband is, let's say, 2% or 3%, but when you stop and search a white driver or pedestrian, the recovery rate is, let's say, 6%, that suggests discrimination. It suggests that the person from whom you're recovering contraband at low rates is being subject to discrimination. You're stopping them too often. You're applying too low a threshold of suspicion. And so you're stopping too many innocent people, and you're recovering too little contraband. And the group from which you're recovering a lot, you should be stopping them more. And you're applying to them too low a standard of suspicion. And this comparison between, you know, the hit rate, you know, how likely is it that you actually do recover something illicit among groups, can be a test of discrimination. Now, there are statistical problems with the application of this text. I won't go into it. It's called the inframarginality problem. It's discussed in the book a bit. But as a first pass, it's not a bad way to try to think about discrimination in stops and searches. So there's a. I'll talk to you about the results from a study in a minute. But here, for example, you've got the number of reported stops. This is the New York City Stop and Frisk program, which is again topical right now with Michael Bloomberg in the debates and in the race. But there was an incredible rise. So it started, of course, you know, in the 1990s, but it rose very, very sharply to almost 700,000 stops a year. Now, that doesn't mean 700,000 people, because some people are being stopped multiple times. Low battery on the computer? Oh. Okay, let's hope it holds up. So that'll be a good way to make sure I keep to my allotted time, maybe by design. So you had at peak about 700,000 stops a year in New York City in the stop and frisk, stop question and frisk program, and it's down to about 10,000 now, partly through litigation and partly through change in administration, and so you've had this big change. But what does the hit rate test tell us, right? What do we know about what those stops resulted in? Because those stops, with such a large number of stops, you've got a lot of data. And there's a bunch of computer scientists and their colleagues who have looked at this data. And they try to see, well, you stopped a lot of people from different groups. What kind of recovery rates do you have? What's your hit rate? So there's this paper by Goel, Rao, and Schroff that looks at 3 million stops. About 4/5 involved Black and Latino civilians. So just as a benchmark, about half of New York City population is Black and Latino. So, 80% of the stops, 50% of the population. So there's disproportionate stops. But again, that's not evidence of discrimination, right? Because there could be reasonable suspicion more frequently with some groups than others. And the overall hit rate for weapon recovery, so they only looked at stops where, the form that the officers have to fill out. There's a form that New York City officers have to fill out to explain what was their suspicion, why did they stop the person? They only look at these forms that said weapon recovery. Out of those forms, about 3% of people actually had weapons, and most of those weapons were knives. But the hit rates were about 2.5% for Black civilians, 3.6% for Latinos, 11% for whites. So just the naive hit rate test is suggesting they're not stopping whites often enough, and they're stopping Black and Latino civilians too much, because more of their stops of Black and Latino pedestrians are unproductive. Actually, they'd recover more contraband by more weapons by evening out a bit, their rates of stop. Now, there's a whole bunch of reasons that, and the authors discuss this, why you shouldn't just take that as face value. You've got to do a whole bunch of tests, to see whether or not condition on location, you still get different recovery rates and so on. And they do all of that. And they basically find that you could have recovered half the weapons with about 6% of stops. So a huge reduction in stops could give you half of the weapons. And we've had a huge reduction in stops. And a disproportionate share of the least productive stops involve searches of Black civilians. And so their conclusion is that optimizing for weapon recovery would simultaneously bring more racial balance. So you actually don't have to be doing the policy in this way. But what are the consequences of the fact that you did it in this way? So here's a more extreme case, NYPD, and I'll tell you, I think I have time. I'm going to finish up by talking about police use of lethal force, and there's many ways in which the New York Police Department is actually among the best in the country with regard to use of lethal force nowadays, right? And even with regard to stops and searches, despite this extreme increase in these stops and searches, there are departments that have been found to be significantly worse. In particular, there was a study of the Ferguson Police Department after the killing of Michael Brown. And this is by the Department of Justice. And they found that really what was driving a lot of the stops in Ferguson was revenue. The municipal, it's easier to try to just get a lot of, give out a lot of citations and get money through fees than to raise municipal taxes. And this is what a bunch of departments have been doing, Ferguson among them. And so they found that the focus on revenue rather than public safety needs, there's a pattern of stops without reasonable suspicion, arrests without probable cause, excessive force, aggressive, unnecessarily aggressive, and at times unlawful policing. And again, this was very, very much disproportionately directed towards the African-American population of Ferguson, which is a majority of that town to begin with. Now, what's the implication of this? Again, now think back to the degree of productivity of the weapons-based stops. If only 3% are recovering weapons, and you stop people for suspicion of weapons, 97% didn't have those weapons. How are those folks going to react to the fact that you stopped them, right? Aside from the, you know, the humiliation of the experience, you know, there's added distress from the fact that you may have been profiled as a consequence of the stop. There's a lot of, you know, had you been stopped at random, for example, which they do in certain places, especially with regard to customs, you know, when you're entering Mexico, for example, and also in some airports in the U.S., there's a randomization device, and you can be stopped randomly. The inconvenience of the search is much less, the distress from the search is much less when you know that it's been executed randomly. The knowledge that it was not can add very substantially to the distress. And this is, you know, a statement by Senator Tim Scott. Tim Scott is, as you know, senator from South Carolina, very conservative on his voting record on most issues, but he gave a very emotional speech in the Senate floor, about 7 minutes long, I think it was, a few years ago, in which he described himself being stopped repeatedly, you know, not being allowed to enter the Senate offices, even though he had the pin that, you know, that's required for entry, and just subject to these kind of humiliations. And, you know, the way he describes it very eloquently is that nothing is more frustrating, more damaging to your soul than when you know you're following the rules and being treated that, like you're not. Now, of course, there's a portion who are stopped who are not following the rules, but there's also a large portion who are, and it's those that are going to be most distressed by it. But from the point of view of my argument today, they will just be completely unwilling to come forward as witnesses. Why on earth would you want additional contact with law enforcement after this kind of experience? And their reluctance, their reticence to come forward as witnesses is going to make it very hard to solve the really tough crimes, including homicides. And if that's the case, then you're going to end up with a low homicide clearance rate, even if you really want to solve these cases. And if you end up with a low homicide clearance rate, you're going to end up with more killing with impunity. If you end up with more killing with impunity, you're going to end up with more killing total, because you're going to have more incentives for preemptive killing. And so high homicide rates, low clearance rates, aggressive policing, they are all connected to each other in this way. So I'll finish up. Do I have about 10 minutes or not quite? Okay. I'll finish up by talking about lethal force. This is obviously one of the most salient issues, actually, in public discourse in the United States now, for good reason. And here, I'll tell you that understanding patterns of lethal force in the United States is not well understood. People have entrenched views. People have what they believe are well-formed views about this, one way or another. But this is what I'm working on now as a follow-up to this book, and there's some really puzzling things in the data that I'm going to present to you, and I'm not going to give you the answers for this. But one thing is clear. United States is like a different world from other economically prosperous countries. About 1,100 civilians killed by police annually in the United States. German police kill about 6 or 9. British police about 2. Now, the U.S. does have a larger population, about 2.5 times as large, but this is a 100-to-1 difference. Also, in the United States, officers are killed with much greater frequency than in Germany and the United Kingdom and other countries at similar levels of prosperity. About 50 officers killed annually in the United States. In the U.K., you know, less than 1 a year on average. Germany, even less than that. So you get both officers killed and you get officers killing of civilians. In the United States, that's very large. Now, you can start to think of some reasons. There's gun prevalence is very high in the U.S. compared to these other countries, for example. But there's something else going on, and I'll just present you the facts, and then, you know, you can think about possible explanations. There's a lot of answers missing in the understanding of this phenomenon. Under the federal standard, when can an officer use lethal force? They cannot use, under the federal standard, they cannot use lethal force just to prevent somebody from running away, right? If somebody is unarmed or just fleeing the scene of a crime, you cannot use deadly force. You can only use it, and, you know, at least since 1985 under the federal standard, when you have probable cause to believe that the suspect poses a significant threat of death or serious physical injury to the officer or to others. So the only legal justification for using lethal force by an officer is actually preemption. And we talked about preemption. And, you know, preemption is going to be conditioned by your beliefs about how dangerous this person is. And those beliefs could well be conditioned by stereotypes. Here's the data from The Guardian. So there's no official data for police homicides. This is from The Guardian. And you see two things. Firstly, the scale is extremely high, right? About 1,100 a year. And then you get white and Asian civilians have the lowest rates of victimization. Latinos in the middle, African-American, Native American civilians have the highest rates. And it varies from year to year. This is 2015 and 16. In particular, the Native American victimization rates jump around a lot because the baseline population is small. So, you know, a couple of extra killings in one year relative to the other can cause these ratios to fluctuate quite a bit. But the patterns are pretty consistent. Now, why is this? So we are trying to think about both the scale and the racial composition, right? And there are two hypotheses that have been advanced, and they're very different from each other, and they're supported by very different kinds of evidence. And the evidence supporting these two hypotheses are both appear to be really quite strong. And so then that raises the question, well, what's going on? What's going on with police killings in the United States? And I, like I said, I'm not going to give you an answer to this. I just want to put this before you. One hypothesis is what might be called the fear hypothesis. The fear hypothesis basically says that stereotypes are affected by threat perception. Remember, you can only kill if you believe, at least legally. I mean, of course, there are examples you have seen where there's no threat, and yet there is a deadly force incident. But the legal standard requires there to be a perception of a threat, and if the perception of a threat is affected by stereotypes, then you're going to end up with people who are perceived as dangerous being killed at higher rates. And there's evidence to support this, and I'll go through some of it. So this is a fear hypothesis. It says that African Americans are killed at higher rates because they are perceived as dangerous, so the threshold at which you pull the trigger is lower, right? You're quicker to pull the trigger because the level of fear is elevated. But there's a counter argument to this, and it's been made in the New York Times by Sandhil Mulanathan, for instance, and Roland Fryer, a couple of other people. And this is what's called the contact hypothesis. And this basically says, look, if you look at the rates at which there's police-civilian contact, it's not the same across different groups. In particular, arrest rates are not the same. And if you condition on contact, so if you compare arrest rates to the rates of victimization with respect to deadly force, you find rough parity, and which suggests that it's not biased once the contact is initiated, although there may be bias with regard to the initiation of contacts. And this is supported by statistical evidence. And so I want to look at these two things and say, look, how do we make sense of these two very different kinds of evidence that's put before us? And then I'll stop. So what's the evidence for the stereotype, you know, affecting threat perception and hence lethal force? So here's, I'm not going to play this video, but you know, it's out there on YouTube. You can take a look at it. This is the most dramatic case that you'll probably see. It's the shooting, luckily non-fatal shooting, of LeVar Jones by Sean Grubert. And basically what the video describes is, you know, it's shown on dash cam video. Grubert's vehicle is parked behind a white pickup truck. Jones gets off of work, gets into the truck, pulls around the corner into a gas station. And it's literally 30 seconds, you know, he pulls around, but he does it without a seatbelt. And Grubert follows him and stops him. And they both have exited the vehicle by the time Grubert asks for license and registration. But the registration is inside the vehicle. So Jones, you know, steps back, you know, leans back into the vehicle to pull out the registration, and Grubert starts shooting him. And it's fascinating, if you've seen this, I mean, because there's a shouting between these two, and you know, Jones is saying, why are you shooting me? You know, and they're actually yelling at each other. And you know, at some point, Grubert realizes make a terrible mistake, calls for help, and asks him if he's shot, and so on and so forth. But it seems as if, you know, this just doesn't make any sense. Why would he be so afraid? He's asked him for registration. He's leaning in to get his registration. And for some reason, he genuinely thought that he's in danger. Now, Grubert was dismissed, actually, by the South Carolina Department of Public Safety. And these were the grounds for dismissal. That he reacted to a perceived threat where there was none. Why? Because it was broad daylight, clear and unobstructed view. There was really no reason to believe that there was a threat here, and yet he imagined this threat, and so, you know, he was dismissed from his job for that reason. He later pled guilty to assault and battery, but there's nothing here in this description that says that he reacted to this perceived threat because LeVar Jones happened to be black and Grubert happened to be white. That's not something that is there in this record, But if you watch the video, it may be, you know, that may be a conclusion that you draw from it, right? That those exaggerated fears arose because of that particular circumstance. Nevertheless, he reacted to a perceived threat where there was none. That's the argument given. You look at the shooting of Philando Castile, Falcon Heights, Minnesota, and the officer, Geronimo Yanes, in his interview with police officers the day afterwards, describes extreme levels of fear. And again, this is the aftermath of the video is available on YouTube. So the evidence of these from these incidents is coming from video and audio mostly. And he says he was in fear of his life. He thought he was going to die. He was scared. You know, I thought he was reaching for the gun. Now, this is a case in which Philando Castile had a gun and was licensed to carry a gun and declared to the officer that he had a gun. His girlfriend was sitting in the passenger seat. There was, I think, a four-year-old girl, the daughter, Diamond Reynolds' daughter, in the back seat. And the circumstance is not one where you would have expected there to be a perception of high threat level. And nevertheless, there it was. Here's one example. And so, you know, the response from the governor of Minnesota was that, you know, he would probably not have been shot if he were white. Peter Moskos was a former Baltimore police officer, and he teaches at John Jay College of Criminal Justice in New York. He also, you know, argued based on the video, with this cop in this locale, I don't think there's a chance in hell he would have been shot if he was white. Fatal shooting of Michael Brown. This is the grand jury testimony of Darren Wilson. Now, this is a very complicated case. I want you to go look at the 5 minutes? Yeah, okay. I want you to go look at the same Department of Justice that looked at the police department practices, which I previously put up, found in the Michael Brown case, reached a very different conclusion. I'm not going to go into it. I'll refer you to the federal report on that. But if you look at Darren Wilson's testimony with regard to the grand jury, it's full of stereotypes, you know, extraordinarily intense stereotypes that he thought he would be running through the bullets and so on, and they were both of comparable height and weight, but he felt that he was holding on to Hulk Hogan and so on. So this is the kind of evidence that is presented for the fear hypothesis, and it's compelling evidence to different degrees to different people, but it's there. Now here's the contact hypothesis. So I just have 5 minutes, so let me just make sure I finish up. So this is an article in the New York Times by Sendil Mullainathan, an economist at Harvard. So he basically says, look, for the entire country, 29% of arrestees roughly were African American, about 32% of police shooting victims are African Americans. If discrimination were a big factor, we would have expected a larger gap between the arrest rate and the killing rate. This in turn suggests that removing police racial bias will have little effect on the killing rate. This was the claim he made. He's stepped back from it a bit in subsequent conversation, discussion. But this is really summarizes what's called the contact hypothesis, that there may be bias in the initiation of contacts, but once there's a contact, the likelihood of lethal force is not that different. Okay? Now, I want to raise two objections to this, and you'll see more detail in the book if you like. One objection is logical, and the other objection is statistical, and then I'll wrap up and stop. What's the logical objection? The logical objection is this. If you're going to use arrests as a benchmark, if you're going to say, look, you know, the rate at which a group is getting arrested is the same as the rate at which they're getting shot, so therefore there doesn't seem to be much bias, you're implicitly assuming that the pool of arrestees is equally dangerous to police, because that's the only reason for them to be using deadly force. Is it justifiable to assume that these two pools, the black pool and the white pool of arrestees, are equally objectively threatening to officers? Not necessarily. Imagine if there was indeed bias in generating the arrests. For example, if certain types of activities, and here you can think about the arrests of Henry Louis Gates on his front porch, Sandra Bland, you know, in Texas, the Starbucks arrestees where they had not purchased, I don't know if you remember this particular incident, it's probably the most recent one. If it is true, again, we never know for sure, but if it is true that these folks under those circumstances would not have been arrested had they been white, then what you're doing is in the arrest behavior of police, you're blowing up, you're expanding the arrest pool. The arrest pool is getting bloated because of people are being added into it when they're black, but not added into the white pool when they're doing the exact same thing or approximately the same thing. Well, what does that do? That not only expands the pool of arrestees, but it actually makes it less dangerous. Because what you're doing is you're adding to this pool people who are not really doing anything that should have gotten them arrested in the first place. And those people are obviously not threats to police, or at least in most cases are not. And so therefore, by expanding the pool in this way, you ought to be making it less dangerous. If you find that the rate of killing is the same across these two pools, that doesn't necessarily indicate the absence of bias. It could well be consistent with the presence of bias. That's the logical objection to this simple comparison between arrest rates and rates of killing. But there's another objection, and this is related to the way in which lethal force is geographically distributed. And here I'm going to show you something about New Mexico that you may or may not know, but which was very striking when I first saw it, and then I'm going to stop. Oh, before I get to that, you can see massive differences across cities in the incidence of lethal force. Houston and LA, you know, no matter whether you're black, Latino, white, you're more likely to be killed by police in Los Angeles and Houston, right? It's about 15.1 per million civilian population than if you're in New York or Philadelphia, Chicago, somewhere in between. So you've got these big differences across cities. Same if you're white. If you're white, you're very unlikely to be killed. In fact, in Chicago, it's very low. New York is comparable, but Houston is high, and Los Angeles is high. No matter which group you belong to, you're at more risk in Houston and LA than New York and Philadelphia and Chicago. However, you're more at risk if you're white in Houston than if you're black in New York City. So the differences in scale are so great that they can sometimes even swamp. Within each city, you see these racial differences. Across cities, if you make the comparison, they can get swamped by the intercity variations in scale. And this makes adding up arrests, for reasons that I don't have time to go into, aggregating these cities can give you very misleading conclusions. Last picture, huge regional clustering. So the green here is the Northeast. States like, you know, New England states, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania. The yellow is the Midwestern states, Wisconsin, Michigan, Iowa. The brown is the Southern states, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida, and so on, Texas. And the red is the West. And right at the bottom up here, the highest rates of lethal force in the Guardian data is New Mexico. And you know, it's not unusual in the sense that the Western states are all clustered at the bottom. New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, California also. And California is a big state, so that's responsible for a large number of killings. This is one of the mysteries that we're trying to do now in follow-up work in a project called the Geography of Lethal Force, trying to understand this geographic variation. And it's not, we can rule out, you know, that it's due to gun prevalence, violent crime variations, or danger to officers themselves, which we are left with selection training and organization culture. But why is this regionally clusters? We don't know. We're just trying to look at that. I won't give you a summary of the argument. I'm out of time, I think. But basically, you know, you can put the pieces together in your head. I'll just finish with Lippmann again. You know, he basically says, look, we can't get away from stereotypes. Erroneous generalization and hostility are natural and common capacities of the human mind. However, his advice is that we, you know, as far as stereotypes are concerned, we hold them lightly and modify them gladly. And I think this is really good advice for all of us. I want to stop there. I just want to thank my co-author, Dan, and then people that I've talked to very productively over the years, Glenn Lowry, Daniel Allen, Sam Bowles of SFI, Libby Wood, and that's my late mother-in-law at the bottom there, to whom the book is dedicated in part. So it's also dedicated to Dan's father-in-law, who was actually an NYPD officer. And if you want to go into the reasons, she had an interesting and very inspiring life, which I leave you to read the acknowledgments of the book to see why. And I think I will stop there.
I know you said you weren't going to answer this, but why is the U.S. an outlier in terms of lethal violence?
So, oh, should I? Sorry. I thought we're collecting questions. I'm sorry. Yeah. Can you hear me? I apologize. I wasn't sure. Sometimes, you know, we collect a few questions and answer. Why is it an outlier? The most obvious thing that one can think of is, firstly, even homicide rates, civilian homicide rates are higher. Gun prevalence is much, much higher. And so those are the obvious things that come to mind. But that doesn't explain these geographic variations. That's the thing that's been puzzling me. So there's more going on than that. If you look at the states, so let me sort of answer your question maybe a bit indirectly. You look at the states with the highest rates of lethal force. There's a pattern to them. Let's go back to here. And I'll see, whoa, okay, so we've swapped out the slides, but basically New Mexico, as I mentioned, Arizona is one, Nevada is one, Alaska is one, Wyoming is one. And then if you, outside of the West, the two states that are outside of the West are Oklahoma and West Virginia. These are the states with the highest rates of lethal force. Every single one of these states actually has less than the average black population in the country. And, you know, there's something in common that they have. I don't know quite what it is, but I think if we can get to the bottom of that, we'll have some answers. But for sure, you know, gun prevalence is a big part of the answer.
I was wondering if you could comment on two things that you didn't really touch on in your talk. One is, we've seen some exonerations of people who were in prison for a long time, yeah, who were convicted because the police seemed to want to get clearances even when there was insufficient evidence, and pressuring, yeah, people in that way. That's the first thing. And the second thing was, there's also a set of property transfer crimes that you might call white collar crimes, where people are often, you know, the people who are engaged in that are basically stealing from the poor and transferring money to the rich. And that's also a kind of crime that I'd love to hear your comments about.
Yeah, so starting with the latter question, that's exactly right. So that actually reinforces quite substantially the point I was making about a difference between the population that we see in among arrestees and incarcerated relative to the population that's out there as offenders. Because, and we talk about this like cyber crimes, for example, embezzlement, cyber bullying. I mean, these are crimes that are not, you know, leading to prison admission or arrest at anything like the same rate. So you've got a picture that we form a picture in our mind. Actually, the word stereotype was constructed to evoke a picture in the mind. And we form these pictures in the mind based on arrest and incarcerated populations, which largely skip these so-called white-collar crimes. There's a few that come, you know, have great visibility, but they're not showing up in large numbers in the arrest pool. And that's exactly right. But again, going back to the earlier argument with regard to if you're gonna be looking at robbery, motor vehicle theft, larceny, and burglary, the reason I looked at those four is because of, you know, the quality of data that we have for those. Those are part of the, what I call the index crimes, and, you know, in the uniform crime reports released by the FBI, and comparing across other crimes of appropriation that you have identified is not apples to apples. It's a bit harder to consolidate those levels of data. But I think the point you made reinforces the fact that the offender pools that we see in terms of arrest and incarcerated is somehow giving us a picture. There's stuff going on there that's hidden from us, and our stereotypes don't get constructed based on what's hidden, which is why we need to hold them lightly and modify them gladly.
I wonder if you could go back to one of the last slides where you said over-policing leads to, and I just can't remember.
I didn't get a chance to. Yeah, I didn't want to. I didn't want to detain you too much, and I felt like I was running out of time. But this is one of the points. Yeah. So basically, the idea is so. Actually, there's a quote at the bottom here by a book, another excellent book by Jill Liovi, who's a writer for the Los Angeles Times, called Ghettocide, and she says that the American criminal justice is at once oppressive and inadequate. So it's oppressive in a sense because it's overly aggressive, and it's inadequate because it's underprotective. And these two things are not random, they're connected to each other. And that's the thread that I've tried to sort of draw out. And the basic argument is that if you have very aggressive policing, especially with regard to relatively minor crimes, and you do it at a scale where a huge number of innocents are going to be stopped and disturbed, and particularly disturbed if you're stopping them, you know, in part based on racial profiling, you're not going to get the witness cooperation you need to solve the really serious crimes. And if you can't do that, then you're going to end up with more of the serious crime through mechanisms of, you know, preemption and retaliation, as I've tried to describe. So you're going to end up with underprotection, not independently of the over-policing. The two things are actually going hand in hand.
So community policing would, seems like it would be the answer.
Yeah.
Yeah,
this is the recommendation. Yeah, these are recommendations that have come out of a number of commissions that have looked at this. That's right. And that's right. In addition, I will say, yeah, community policing, yes, absolutely.
Can you tell us what that is? But,
sorry?
Can you tell us what that is?
Oh, just general, you know, contact that is not based on the occurrence of a crime. You know, the example that's used sometimes mockingly is, you know, fixing fences and stuff like that. You know, just generally participating in community activities in ways, you know, basketball clubs. I mean, participating in community activities that are not related to the commission of a crime. And that's part of it. But we also think, actually, and we've discussed this in the book, we also think that trying to retain, you know, talented homicide detectives, retirement ages are very low. And there are incentives, and you know, there are incentives to retire relatively early, and sometimes people are retiring in their prime, you know, and if you want to solve cases, and, you know, Jill Leovi's book actually gives some examples of how much variation there is in just in the ability of people to actually do the job. You know, there's a case to be made for more detectives and more, you know, detective work with regard to improving the clearance rate. That could complement and go hand in hand with community policing. I don't think community policing alone is going to solve this. You need lots of different ways to act on the clearance rate.
Sorry, people can't hear me. So you've detailed well the kind of endless cycle that goes on once the stereotype happens,
yeah,
and then all these kinds of downstream effects. But you, at the beginning, you were talking about different stereotypes that existed in the late 19th yeah. century versus now. Where are they coming from, and what is feeding that particular mechanism, and how? What are the dynamics of those stereotypes?
Yeah, where is it coming from? It's a big question. I can speculate. I don't have a whole lot of expertise to answer that. But there's something called, you know, the Princeton study. So basically in the 1930s, they went and took 100 Princeton students and they asked them to associate adjectives with groups, and they gave them 10 groups, you know? And, you know, for example, the stereotype of Germans was scientifically minded. You know, the stereotype of the British was sportsmanlike. The stereotype of Turks at that time was cruel. Stereotypes of Chinese at that time and stereotypes for Jews at that time were both quite similar, sort of cunning, you know? So you had this sort of stereotypes, some very negative, some very positive. And then they had four waves of this study. So they did it every 20 years or so, and they tried to see how these stereotypes were changing over time. And for African Americans in particular, there were stereotypes, the early period have stereotypes about, you know, things like laziness. Then it gets to musicality. Then it gets to, you know, loudness and aggression, and you see these changes, and of course the population itself is changing. You've got Princeton admitted no women and no non-whites actually in the first time the study was done. Same with the second. Then you start getting African Americans in Princeton post-war, essentially. Then you get women, I think, in 1968, and so, you know, the population of Princeton is changing. So then they look at the responses of subgroups of this population. You can see the evolution of stereotypes, but, you know, yeah, popular culture has to be a part of it. Part of it has to also be with regard to data, the data that is presented to us. One of the points that I was trying to make is that people form their stereotypes based on looking at, you know, pictures of wanted folks, you know, surveillance tapes, you know, arrestees, those who are incarcerated, they don't form their stereotypes on the folks who are committing offenses without getting apprehended. So that's got to be part of what's going on too. Yeah, but I know that's not a very convincing answer.
Okay, cool. So regarding the American, violence rate or shooting rate between cops and whatever, it's 1,100 or something like that. How do you view, the inherent American skepticism of social institutions playing a role into that, from a more sociological perspective?
Yeah, I think that may be part of why the West is wild, right? And Oklahoma and West Virginia. Yeah, I think that's part of it. The question is, for somebody who's a social scientist, what kind of data do you use to address this? How do you capture this kind of skepticism, this kind of, reaction to being subjected to, inconvenience or humiliation? My gut tells me that's important. But I still don't know how I would measure it and test it and see. It's not easy. Yeah, I don't think it's negligible though. But again, it's just speculative on my part.
So I'm looking for a little hope here. Do you see anything in the data or what you're doing that leads to a point where we're decreasing all of these bad things, the biases and the stereotypes and such?
Gosh, what we're decreasing for sure, one thing I showed you where you had this huge decrease was New York City stop and frisk, right? Went up to 700,000, down to 10,000. So in some ways, you're getting that kind of trend in some places. One thing that has decreased a lot since the 1990s across the board is crime in general. It's much, much lower across the board than it was. There's blips, there's a few years where it goes up and down, but we've had two and a half decades of very serious, very strong reductions in overall incidence of these so-called index crimes. Other things seem to be getting worse. It seems to me, certainly hate crimes are up quite substantially. It's a mixed bag. Yeah.
I have two questions. The first is, when you're looking at the increase in stereotypes, which you said has happened from the 1900s till now,
yeah,
how much do you think technology and the continual disbursement of news or information has added to that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Again, I have to confess to not having a whole lot of expertise to answer it, but there's very active research right now on the most recent technologies, like online technologies, social media and so on, in spreading misinformation, fake news, and so on. That's a very active area of research, and there's some evidence to suggest that.
And do you think the anonymous spreading of news, via the internet sources where you don't have to be face-to-face or even a face, but just putting the data out there also?
Intuitively, it would seem to me that's got to be, a major factor, for example, driving polarization and so on. But the research that I know has not found statistical evidence of those effects that's very convincing at this point. That's all I can say. There isn't a whole lot of evidence that, Twitter and Facebook and social media has really can be held responsible for the increased polarization relative to, let's say, broadcast television news, which is still a much bigger part of people's media consumption.
I guess the last question has a totally different topic. When you're looking at the states that have the highest levels of violence, is there a correlation with the education level within those states?
I don't know. It could be. That's one of the things that we have not looked at. So, at least when we were looking at the geography of lethal force, the more obvious determinants were, okay, how much risk are the officers themselves in? How much is the violent crime rate in general? What is the gun ownership rates, and so on. But we have not looked at education specifically, and we probably should. I don't know the answer to that. It seems as if it would be a factor.
Yeah. Okay, we have one last question.
I'm just curious, in your studies, did you look at a correlation between stereotyping and the unreliability of eyewitness testimony?
So, yeah, we looked at, we looked at this to some degree, but there's another book I will recommend to you by Jennifer Eberhardt. I think it's called Biased, and there, she actually talks about the inability of people to reliably identify others in eyewitness testimony when they don't belong to your own social group, especially when you're in segregated circles. And this is something that happens to, you know, across the board. Elizabeth Anderson also makes this point. And in fact, one of her main points that she makes in the book that I referenced is precisely that the greater the degree of segregation in our social contacts, the less reliable eyewitness testimony becomes when that testimony involves people outside of our own group. Right? You're able to more easily distinguish people and more reliably identify people if they're the kind of people you spend most of your time with. As soon as you cross the boundary and try to identify folks who are outside the sort of ambit of your usual daily experience, you start making a lot of mistakes. So that's kind of well documented, and that sort of links segregation to reliability of eyewitness testimony. That is not my research, but there's research that suggests that quite strongly.
Okay, can we get another round of applause for Rajiv Sethi?
Thank you all very much for coming. Our next lecture is by Sarah Walker on March 24th, titled